like that, and had the various rooms that you'd go into and all that.
Now, one of my favorite examples of how Walt worked and how Disneyland works was the Viewliner, the Train of Tomorrow, which a lot of people don't even know was ever here. It opened in 1957 and closed in 1958. It was here for a year and a half. And basically, it was the monorail, but it rode on railroad tracks. It rode on regular train tracks on the ground instead of up elevated above. Then, right after the Viewliner opened, Walt discovered the monorail in Germany running around on a test track. And he said, well, that's what I want. Came back and built a monorail that opened in 1959.
On the gala celebration of the completion of the project, the Richard Nixon family were on hand to snip the ribbon. Here we were with our monorail, the forerunner of rapid transit of the future, all checked out and ready to go, but somebody forgot to check out the scissors. Oh, to heck with it. If you can't cut it, break it. Right.
In 1959, when we reopened the park and rededicated the park, we opened the Matterhorn, we opened the Sud Ride, and we opened the monorails all in one day. It was brutal, but it was fun. It was exciting. It was interesting, and it made it work.
I can remember asking Walt that could we come up with some kind of a thrill attraction. And Walt says, Nunes, this is not an amusement park. And I says, no, sir, I realize that, but we really need to do what the guests want, and they want a thrill attraction.
Our Matterhorn was scaled for the first time on its inauguration. Since then, during the vacation months, climbing it has become a daily event.
The submarine voyage was a type of ride that really hadn't been attempted by many other amusement parks. And so the people riding in these submarines and getting the impression that they were submerging was really exciting.
The submarines themselves were designed to look very real and very official, and they had, you know, names like the Polaris and the Skipjack and, of course, the Nautilus after 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. So it wasn't played for laughs. It wasn't like a whimsical submarine ride. It was a very real one that had some elements of whimsy kind of integrated in there, just kind of behind the scenes. They had live mermaids that were kind of sunning themselves on the coral reefs and the rocks, and they had giant props. They had lyres and mirrors and jewels, and they held auditions in the pool at the Disneyland Hotel and tell people that, you know, well, we'll supply the mermaid fin, you know, if you will show up and prove your swimming abilities. There are many stories of rather ardent young men who admired the mermaids greatly, who wanted to get much closer. I guess they were heeding the siren song and found their way over the fence and into the submarine lagoons.
And you see where it was placed in the park. It was right between mm-hmm. Fantasyland and Tomorrowland.
The perfect segue yeah. between the two.
You know, Walt had one foot in the past and one foot in the future.
Hello. Welcome to the moon.
Tomorrow is a heck of a thing to keep up with.
As the years went by, everything there started looking older and older and older.
And now, here in Disneyland, the year is 1986. 1986. That's way ahead.
Now, this will give you a pretty good idea of the rocket ship in which you will soon be traveling to the moon. In this section are two television screens, one above and another one below.
So this rocket to the moon attraction was a very popular one. And when we finally went to the moon, it got kind of passé.
I know my kids back home would sure get a kick out of that.
So it was eventually changed to Mission to Mars.
And that's not all. Watch this.
It went from kind of flat and gray to a less so, a little more friendly in 1967 with the addition of the moving vehicles and the people mover. Of course, that was the time of polyester, you know, the future fabric for everyone, special wear-dated fabrics and things. And so you had all those polyester wear-dated fabrics made into tunics and all kinds of very chic late 60s clothing.
In fact, they're the latest thing in moon fashions. But enough of that.
With the 98 Tomorrowland, you had a much more residential kind of future, I guess you could say, because you had plants and you had a bit more of an accessible future.
Well, Walt once said to me, not once, he said several times, I dream that one day nobody shows up. That's my nightmare. He knew that the show had to be fresh, that there had to be a new reason to come back. And the nature of getting people to come back is visibility and exposure, but it's mostly something new to talk about.
We created a new type of animation, so new that we had to invent a new name for it.
Audio animatronics?
Right, audio animatronics.
Walt came in and said, I want to do a little tea room, but he said, I want it to be, you know, like Polynesian, kind of a tiki room.
Oh, look at all the people. Welcome to Walt Disney's Enchanted Tiki Room.
Dick Irvine, who was in charge of WET at that time, asked John Hench to do a rendering of what the inside of the tiki room would look like. John held up his picture, and of course, in there, there was pictures of birds in cages. And he says, you can't do that, John. And John said, why not? He says, because he'll poop in the food. No. He looks like a real bird, but it's not. He's just kind of a little mechanical bird. And then somebody else said, wow, maybe that bird would whistle to another bird. And then that bird would whistle back to another. And then, you know, maybe they might even sing a little.
In the tiki, 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 tiki room. In the tiki, 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 tiki room. All the birds sing
words. Now we're making these human figures, dimensional human figures move.
Ever since I was a small boy in Illinois, I've had a great personal admiration for Abraham Lincoln. During our exhaustive research into Lincoln's life, we studied his mannerisms, his gestures, and even his voice characteristics to create a faithful likeness of this honored man. The final result is so lifelike that you might find it hard to believe.
We had great technical difficulties in getting the character to move properly in New York, and God would be going great, and then all of a sudden he would do a great jerk or decide to sit down.
The figure was not perfect, and not all the parts worked as they should. And as Mr. Lincoln made a gesture at one point, not all of his hand worked in the same fashion as it should have. And not all the fingers were symmetrical. I'll leave it to that.
Girls, can you let that go for a while? We just want to do a dry run on this thing.
Okay, Wathel, you ready? This is the stage for Act One of the Carousel Theater Progress. Stages for the other acts are being assembled at other places in the studio for a complete audio animatronic dress rehearsal. Now, this contraption here might look like something from outer space, but it's actually a control harness for programming the actions and gestures of our audio animatronic figures.
They had this wonderful concept of the people sitting in the carousel and moving around to different stages of the development in the world of electric facilities.
Shall we show them how it works?
Really, Walt.
This is the carousel theater host. Whatever the man in the harness does, this figure will respond simultaneously in the same manner. Would you care for a light? I don't think we better. No smoking on the stage.
And he asked us to write something that give the theme of what it was like what the whole era was all about. And also, it could be played in ragtime and in jazz and in Dixieland and then into popular music. The same song could be played.